Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this morning. I have a couple announcements that I want to share with you. When we get to the hymn of the day, just follow what's up on the screen. The hymn of the day was changed after Jill printed the bulletin. She went on vacation. So we just wanted to let you know that follow what's up on the screen. We'll be all good for the hymn of the day. Reminder that Adult Ed is meeting after worship service today. They'll be meeting in the great room over there. Anybody else is invited to stick around after worship today. We will have a planning meeting where we'll begin conversations towards or continuing the interim process, getting some of your feedback, some input. So if you're able to stick around after the service, please stick around. If you've already attended the previous one that we had 2 weeks ago, you don't need to come unless you have extra ideas. It'll be the exact same content and format. So if you already attended, you don't need to. But if you haven't, we'd encourage you to stick around for the meeting today after the service. Another announcement reminder, if you want to adorn the altar area with flowers for the Easter service, please go ahead and fill out those forms to fill out whatever types of flowers you may want. Unfortunately, as they put in the announcements, I am allergic to lilies and a few other flowers. So we have other flower choices, but there will be some really nice looking fake lilies up there. So we are going to get some. So you will have lilies. They just won't affect me during the service. So please sign up for the flowers if you are interested in that. And I think that's it for the announcements, except for the critical announcements. The most critical of all is some results from our votes. So we had Blessed Assurance and Lift High the Cross side by side. This is getting more and more challenging as we go. So we had, what do you think? Yeah, Lift High the Cross, pulled out, 73%. So that one was a clear pull away. Another clear pull away was Jesus Christ is risen today and thine is the glory. Yeah, there we go. Jesus Christ is risen today, pulled ahead with 72% on that one. Another really almost three quarters of the vote. Another one that was kind of close was, Great is thy faithfulness, and be thou my vision. Great is thy faithfulness, that's what I'm hearing more of, and that was the winner, Great is thy faithfulness. Then we had one of the closest ones, A mighty fortress is our God, and how great thou art. I'm hearing how great thou art. Do I hear any mighty fortresses out there? Tim, what do you think? How great thou art. Yeah, how great thou art. It was really close. That one was 55% to 45%, so it was really tight. Clear pull away, Silent Night took out Go Tell It on the Mountain in that pitting side by side. I thought it was going to go the other way. Another really close one was I Wonder as I Wander and Take My Life That I May Be. Take My Life. And Take My Life did pull ahead with 55 to 45, another really close one. So some interesting results. There were a lot more votes this week than previous weeks. Every week we're getting more and more. So if you have not voted for the new week, please stop by the desk and fill those out. We'd be interested to hear your input on those last few songs, and I'll share some other results after the service is over with the second half of the results. So let's continue our service with our prelude. Thank you. Please stand as you're able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who writes the law on our hearts, who draws all people together through Jesus. Amen. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts grow into hatred. For all these things, and for sins only you know, forgive us, Lord. Amen. Here's the flood of grace. Out of love for the world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Mercy on us, Christ, and wash
O God, rich in mercy, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. And any youth that are interested can head on back for children's time.
The first reading for this morning is taken from the book of Numbers, the 21st chapter. From Mount Hor, the Israelites set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. God's holy story for us. Help us model your words.
Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for God's mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim that God redeemed them from the hand of the foe, gathering them in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some were fools and took rebellious paths. Through their sins they were afflicted. They loathed all manner of food and drew near to death's door. Then in their trouble they cried to the Lord, and you delivered them. Sent forth your word and healed them and rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people. Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and tell of your deeds with shouts of joy.
As you hear the second reading, I hope you will listen, take heart to these words, for these are some of the most powerful for our faith and our beliefs as Lutherans, Christians. The second reading is from Ephesians 2, verses 1 to 10. "Now you were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved." and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Not the results of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. God's holy story for us. Help us follow here.
We hear today God's holy words from the third chapter of John. Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and the people loved darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it might be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Jesus, you have spoken to us.
Now guide us, Lord.
You may be seated. Pray with me. God, we gather to hear your word. Let it take root in us, and send us forth, renewed in your spirit. Amen. So today, you might have noticed a theme in the readings. It's the cross. But why the cross? What's so important about the cross? And God, after all, said we shouldn't have idols, right? Yet we have crosses all over the place. It's on top of church roofs. People have it hanging on their walls. They have it hanging around their necks. They have charms with crosses. Crosses everywhere. And while we don't necessarily idolize crosses, we certainly use them a lot in our life, don't we? We see an early form of the cross from the Old Testament reading in Numbers, where Moses is lifting up a serpent on a pole that looks like a cross, as a way for people to live after being bitten by poisonous snakes. In the gospel, we read about Jesus dying on the cross as a way for people to live. The cross seems to be at the center of our Christian faith, and the cross seems to mean a lot to us. Both positive and negative images of the cross. It's also a reminder of sin, torture, but love, presence of God, forgiveness, sacrifice, salvation, the center image for our Christian faith. The cross seems to be this confusing object, and yet explains everything, and yet leaves us wondering, all at the same time, this paradox of the cross. The Old Testament authors talk about a leader from Jesse's tree that would one day come and bring salvation to God's people. The long-awaited Messiah, someone like King David, that would bring back the glory days of old, restore and rescue the people of Israel. People in Jesus' day thought that Jesus was just that person, someone to come and rescue them from the empire. A good fit for an earthly king would free them from the Roman occupation, which was dominating a huge chunk of the world at the time. They were hopeful, and they looked to Jesus like this figure. Once Jesus was king, they thought everything would be better. At least, that was the hope seen by the people following Jesus. The New Testament authors were writing to the early Christians who were trying to make sense of the cross and share the good news they found based on what Jesus taught. Many in the early Christian community who had been following Jesus and hoping that he was the Messiah suddenly began to get discouraged after Jesus had died. Then he was risen, but he hadn't come back for the final time. And they thought Jesus would return a lot faster. And they waited, and they waited longer. They also couldn't separate the idea of an earthly king versus the heavenly king. Remember, the disciples, after Jesus' death, were locked up in a house. They left the tomb despondent. They walked the road to Emmaus, lost, wandering that road. The Gospels were written to make sense of the cross and Jesus' resurrection. And as the people began to study the Old Testament scrolls and the stories of Jesus, scholars and teachers began to see a new picture of who Jesus was and what Jesus really meant to accomplish during his ministry. They realized that the cross changed their perspective of Jesus' goals when seen through death and resurrection. The early Christians shifted their belief and now believed Jesus was the Messiah, despite what happened on the cross and because of the resurrection. And slowly, a new hope began to arise among the community. Martin Luther also struggled in faith. He, along with many in the Middle Ages, taught and preached, and they had this image of God as this powerful, vindictive God who loved to smite. Smite is a fun word, isn't it? Smite. How could Luther go about his day knowing that he might sin and that God might finally decide that was the last time for you, Luther? Smite. So Martin spent a lot of time locked up in prayer and confession and praying for forgiveness. He got stuck in this pattern, and for a while he wouldn't interact with the world. That is, until he was reading the scripture and it finally dawned on him. The cross. When Martin saw God in light of the cross and his image of who God is suddenly changed. God was no longer out there to get you, not a smiting God, but instead, God had a vulnerable human side. God is approachable. God is present. God is incarnate in the flesh. Rather than ruling in a galaxy far, far away, God forgives and continues to forgive. 70 times 7, otherwise known as almost unlimited or unlimited, rather than a few times. Mercy and grace flowed freely rather than being used sparingly. And now Martin Luther saw that God is a powerful and holy God, but through Jesus on the cross, God is also approachable, loving, and understanding. And this was the God we finally saw on the cross. A God willing to suffer for our sake and who loves us enough to become like a loving, unrelenting parent for us. So this is where we turn to claim or reclaim the cross. We see in our reading from Numbers that we heard today where the people were bitten by the snakes. What if this was the interpretation of the people that God sent the snakes? And in reality, maybe they had just stumbled into a bad stretch of wilderness that was populated with a lot of poisonous snakes. Maybe the author of Numbers said God sent the snakes as a meaning to scare the people who heard the story later. There's many possible interpretations for the story. But reading the story with Martin Luther's insight shows us a different interpretation of the story, which may make more sense in line with a loving God. It's then that we don't see a judgmental God out to exact vengeance on the people who had strayed again, but it's possible to see God providing a means of relief and care for people who wandered off the trail and sinned one more time. Like we heard in our second reading, by grace you have been saved by faith. God relies on faith, but God exacts judgment. Like that. God acts in a reading from Ephesians and sets aside all our past sins and acts with rich mercy and great love. By God's grace, we have been saved. God, the loving parent, looks out for us and sets a place aside for us in heaven, a gift for us, not based on what we've done. Loving God who desires to be with us. From John, our gospel reading today, it's clear, also one of my favorite verses, John 3:17, not 3:16. God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, but that the world may be saved through him. We hear of Jesus who didn't come down to the earth and eventually to the cross to condemn the people for their sins, but to save them and draw them all together. Luther encourages us not to say who God should be, but what God actually does. When we talk about God and what God does in our lives and how God acted through this body of believers and how we've witnessed God acting in the world, we speak to the God who is rather than who we want God to be. Tell others how God has been a part of your life. Share stories of God at work in you and what you've seen happen in your life. People of God, continue sharing the living gospel message of love with a new view of the cross as we continue in the season of Lent. Amen.
Hymn of the day is 334.
To see you clearly, make us children.
trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. Gracious God, your love unites. Give vision to the global church and foster cooperation in mission. Increase interreligious understanding and ecumenical dialogue. Make your church a sanctuary for all fleeing persecution, disaster, and war. Creating God, your love enlivens. Restore balance to the earth's fragile habitats. Preserve wilderness lands, rainforests, and wildlife. Cleanse oceans and rivers. Make us good stewards of the earth. Righteous God, your love liberates. We give thanks for those who courageously witness to your liberating love. Free all people from the evils of racism, religious strife, and hatred. And together we sing. Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. Merciful God, your love heals. Strengthen healthcare workers, first responders, and caregivers. Relieve all who live with chronic illness and pain, especially those we name aloud or in our hearts now. Incarnate God, your love enlightens. Open our hearts and minds to fresh understandings of our faith. Deepen our love for you and for one another. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Abiding God, your love saves. Those who died in the faith are made alive in Christ. We give thanks for your promise that we also will be raised to newness of life. And together we sing. Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another. Let us pray. Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal. Bless these gifts that we have gathered that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with this holy food, but with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
God of amazing goodness, wiping out shadows with twinkling stars, filling rivers and oceans with living waters, pouring the waters into rivers and seas, sowing seeds of wonder into the fields. You shaped us, your children, out of the dust of the earth, handing us all the beauty and joy which flows ceaselessly from your heart. But we ground your hopes into the dirt, and we race to catch up with death, clutching tight to temptation's gifts. Yet, however far we tried to go, wherever we thought you couldn't find us, you were there waiting for us to remind us of your great love, longing to keep your promises of faithfulness. With our kindred everywhere, in the silence of our loneliness and in the shadows of uncertainty, together we sing this song of praise. Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We join together in the words our Lord has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. In this meal, righteousness, peace, grace, and God's presence abounds. All are invited to God's table to receive sacraments. Red liquid is wine. There is gold liquid, which is grape juice. We have regular wafers, and we have gluten-free wafers. So let us know as you come forward to receive this sacrament. And if you took prepackaged communion on your way in, you're welcome to commune yourself at any time.
Guilty sod, and to become a lamb.
Please stand as you're able. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat were gathered into one bread, now make us into one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life.
Amen.
Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, and renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace.
Amen.
Reminder, encouragement to stick around after the worship service. After a few minutes, we'll gather back in here for a vision planning meeting. Everybody is welcome to attend. Like I said, it'll be the same as 2 weeks ago if you attended that, but you're welcome to come back again if you'd like. Also, a reminder that the new week of voting is out there for the songs. We're getting down to the final few. It's getting harder and harder each week, but you can do it. You can do it. Or at least try to do it. Try to pick your favorite songs out of all those. Final few announcement winners of a few other songs that we haven't mentioned yet. We had, it was Great Is Thy Faithfulness and Be Thou My Vision. That was 50-50. Yeah, it was pretty close voting, too. Great Is Thy Faithfulness, pulled ahead of Be Thou My Vision on that one. Just a Closer Walk with Thee and Born and Cry. Super tight race. It was about 50-50 in voting, and a 50-50 is kind of what I'm hearing here. And Just a Closer Walk with Thee, skimmed by just a few votes. Have no fear, little flock, and joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Joyful, joyful, a runaway winner in that one. Beautiful Savior, and I know my Redeemer lives. Another two hard ones to pick. Beautiful Savior pulled ahead in that one. And then we had another close one. What a friend we have in Jesus, and I love to tell the story. Tim, what do you think on that one? I love to tell the story. Pulled ahead on that one. So, my wife and I have differing tastes on cookies. She likes the cookies when they come right out of the oven, and I like them after everything has settled down and come to room temperature and the chocolate chip is solidified. Also, when I go to a restaurant and order a brownie, they serve it to me hot. I like mine cold. So tell me on your way out, do you like your cake, pie, cookies, brownies, hot, room temperature, or cold? Share that with me on your way out. Go in peace. Spread the word.
Thanks be to God.